Hello and welcome. The primary concentration of this video will be to explore the conditions of the current presidential debates, which have been criticized as pageantry and debased to a glorified press conference. We'll also explore the reasons third-party candidates are routinely excluded, regardless of electoral eligibility. It seems like every 4 years we have to make a choice that is limited to the lesser of two evils. Why is it that in a supposedly free and pluralist nation, we have to vote for evil at all? Is there really only two options for the presidency? Am I wasting my vote if I vote independent or third party? To answer these questions, let's take a look at the history of presidential debates and examine how people have access to information regarding presidential candidates.
The first televised presidential debates between Kennedy and Nixon in 1960 were sponsored by the networks. President Lyndon Johnson refused to debate his opponent, Barry Goldwater, in 1964. And the next debate didn't occur until 1976. By then, the nonpartisan League of Women Voters had become the sponsor. Republican John Anderson had served in Congress for almost 20 years before becoming an independent candidate for president.
The man who should be here tonight...
President Jimmy Carter at the time refused to debate Anderson because he thought Anderson would take more votes away from him. So the League was confronted with a dilemma. Does it capitulate to the President of the United States, or does it invite an independent candidate that the American people want to see? Well, the League had guts, and it went forward and invited Anderson to participate in a 1980 presidential debate, even though President Carter refused to show up in front of 50 million viewers.
In 1984, 4 years later, the League had to stand up once again to intimidation from the major party candidates. Ronald Reagan and Walter Mondale kept vetoing every journalist the League proposed as a questioner.
The campaigns got together and tried to get rid of all the difficult questions. What did the League do? Well, instead of silently accepting this reality, it held a press conference in Washington, and it lambasted the candidates for, quote, totally abusing the process.
Moderator Barbara Walters was left without a full panel of journalists.
The candidates were given a list of almost 100 qualified journalists from all the media and could agree on only these three fine journalists. As moderator and on behalf of my fellow journalists, I very much regret, as does the League of Women Voters, that this situation has occurred.
So the two parties got together.
Michael Dukakis and George H.W. Bush negotiated the first memoranda of understanding in 1988. So they handed it to the League. The League said, what is this? We don't do this. We don't put our respected name and trusted name onto a secret document you've negotiated. We refuse to implement it.
The League of Women Voters is announcing today that we have no intention of becoming an accessory to the hoodwinking of the American public. Under these circumstances, the League is withdrawing its sponsorship of the presidential debates.
It's precisely because the League of Women Voters was willing to fight on behalf of the public interest and refused to comply with the secret demands of the Republican Democratic nominees that the parties got together and created their own compliant commission.
And that's how the Commission on Presidential Debates came into being. It has supervised every presidential debate since 1988. The Commission is in fact a private corporation, founded by the then chairman of the Republican and Democratic National Parties. They are still running the show.
The biggest lobbyist for the gaming industry. The other is a lobbyist as well, both. Frank Fahrenkopf and Kirk produced. They were producers, so they decided which candidates the voters could see. And their sponsors were Bud, Anheuser-Busch, U.S. Airwaves, corporations.
The national sponsors of the Commission on Presidential Debates include 1992 AT&T, Atlantic Richfield, Dun & Bradstreet, Ford Motor Company, Hallmark, IBM, J.P. Morgan, Philip Morris, Prudential, 1996 Anheuser-Busch, Dun & Bradstreet, Lucent Technologies, Philip Morris, Sara Lee, Sprint, 2000 Anheuser-Busch, U.S. Airwaves, 3Com. You say that this results in the debates becoming corporate carnivals.
If you attend a debate site, what you see are huge Anheuser-Busch tents, Anheuser-Busch girls in skimpy outfits, and they're passing out beer. They're passing out pamphlets that denounce beer taxes.
The public at home never sees this.
Oh, they never see this. They never see this. These are the corporations that are primarily paying for the debates that tens of millions of Americans are watching.
But not until the publication of George Farrow's book this year had anyone but a handful of insiders seen the secret contracts for the last three debates, negotiated between the candidates and then handed to the debate commission. Those contracts were leaked to Farah.
It's a binding contract, and this contract dictates who will participate, who will ask the questions, the heights of the podiums, every detail conceivable.
Is the vice president right?
It's a glorified bipartisan press conference. They get a question from a moderator that they selected and they can predict, they've memorized a response to. They issue the memorized soundbite, which fits a very nice, perfect 90-second response slot that has been stipulated in the contract. Their opponent cannot challenge their answer because they're prohibited by the contract. The moderator can't challenge their answer because they can't ask follow-up questions. Imagine, for a moment, if we could have a debate in which the candidates actually responded to each other. That's what a debate is.
The result, he says, is an event tightly controlled by the candidates, a glorified press conference with rules rigged to serve the candidates, not the public. Listen to moderator Jim Lehrer as he opened the 2000 debate between George W. Bush and Al Gore.
Tonight's we'll have the candidates at podiums. No answer to a question can exceed 2 minutes. The candidates, under their rules, may not question each other directly.
Those were the rules the candidates demanded for a reason.
Because if the candidates were forced to be confrontational, if the candidates were forced to engage in spontaneous discourse, if the candidates were forced to confront issues they were uncomfortable with, they might make a mistake.
That's just what happened to the first President Bush back in 1992 during the town hall debate with challengers Ross Perot and Bill Clinton.
How has the national debt personally affected each of your lives? And if it hasn't, how can you honestly find a cure for the economic problems of the common people if you have no experience in what's ailing them?
I think the national debt affects everybody. Obviously, it has a lot to do with interest rates. It has.
She's saying you personally.
On a personal basis, how has it affected you?
The president was very flustered with the question. He didn't know how to handle it. What do you mean affect me?
I'm not sure I get it. Help me with the question and I'll try to answer it.
Well, this revealed to much of the public that he had a very difficult time relating to everyday working people and how they are affected possibly by the budget deficit. And it's precisely because of that that the candidates decided afterwards for the next two election cycles and in this election cycle to manipulate and sanitize the town hall format.
The candidates got their way.
The audience participants are bound by the following rule. They shall not ask follow-up questions or otherwise participate in the extended discussion, and the questioner's microphone will be turned off after he or she completes asking the question.
What's more, town hall questions would have to be submitted in advance.
These folks submitted 18 questions on education, and the first one will be asked by Angie Pettig. Angie Pettig, where are you?
They had every member in the town hall audience write their questions on index cards and give them to Jim Lehrer. He would point to the individual and have him ask the question. The consequence, of course, is no matter how good of a person Jim Lehrer is, he's still asking all the questions. The audience members are just there as props. He's still picking the ones to be asked. So it shows you the sanitization of the town hall format shows you the evolution of how the candidates are increasingly controlling whatever they can control to avoid mistakes.
Let's go back to the second debate in 2000. You say that was probably the most agreeable presidential debate in history.
Yeah, I agree.
I agree with that. The governor and I agree.
I think the administration did the right thing.
I agree with that.
You have a different view of that?
No, I don't really.
I agree with Governor Bush that we should have new accountability, testing of students.
You know, I supported the administration in Columbia.
They agreed that we should prevent gays from being allowed to marry.
A marriage should be between a man and a woman.
Vice President Gore?
I agree with that.
They agreed to sign a racial profiling law, bail out Mexico with IMF loans.
Is there any difference?
I haven't heard a big difference right in the last few exchanges.
Well, I think it's hard to tell.
And later on in that debate,
Bush said...
It seems like we're having a great love fest tonight.
We're having a great love fest right now. You remember that?
Absolutely, I remember that. The point of the presidential debates is to highlight the differences in an authentic discussion for the American people. And when you have a debate like you see in 2000, with a moderator posing very simple questions, and with the candidates agreeing on those questions and actually not being able to address each other, you end up with 37% of the answers in the candidates agreeing with each other. And when Bush said we're having a great love fest, it doesn't just relate to the fact that on the various issues they're agreeing on, it also relates to the fact that they're not even confronting each other in debate. It should be a more confrontational process, with candidate A saying, I disagree with that point, I challenge that point. And in 2000, when Gore tried to challenge President Bush and tried to raise a question to President Bush, the moderator said, now, Vice President, you have to stop. You're violating the rules.
Both of you now have violated, both of you have now violated your own rules. Hold that thought.
I've been trying so hard not to.
I know, but about, you're not... Under your all's rules, you are not allowed to ask each other a question. I let you do it a moment ago.
Twice.
Now you just, twice, sorry. Okay.
That's an interruption.
Okay. But anyhow, you just did it, so now we're not
fighting.
That's all right. It's okay.
I apologize, Mr. Vice President. No,
you're not allowed to do that either, see?
No, I mean.
Mr. Vice President, you heard what he said.
So what happens if there's a moment of spontaneous debate?
Affirmative action doesn't mean
good
quotas. Are you for it without quotas?
Well, I may not be for your version, Mr. Vice President, but I'm for what I just described to the lady.
Are you for what the Supreme Court says is a constitutional way of having affirmative action?
Jim, just
let's go on to another, and
it's a question.
No, it doesn't speak for itself, Mr. Vice President. It speaks for the fact that there are certain rules in this that we all agree to, but evidently rules don't mean anything.
So the Commission on Presidential Debates, a private corporation headed by the former chairman of the Republican and Democratic parties, allows candidates to essentially neuter the presidential debates. Are they also responsible for the exclusion of third parties?
Something else the public didn't know. The secret contracts gave the Republican and Democratic candidates veto power over other participants.
Gentlemen, good evening.
Good evening, Jim.
In 1992, the Republicans believed candidate Ross Perot would hurt Bill Clinton's chances, and the Democrats didn't want to alienate Perot supporters. So the two parties invited the feisty Texan to take part in the debates.
Now all these fellas with $1,000 suits and alligator shoes running up and down the halls of Congress that make policy now, the lobbyists, the PAC guys, the foreign lobbyists, what have you, they'll be over there in the Smithsonian, you know. Because we're going to get rid of them.
But 4 years later, in 1996, neither side wanted Perot there.
1996 is a wonderful example of what happens when the candidates control the presidential debate process. Bill Clinton, who was the Democratic nominee, and Bob Dole, who was the Republican nominee, hatched a secret agreement to exclude Ross Perot from the presidential debates. Bob Dole desperately wanted Perot excluded because he thought that Perot would take more votes away from him, and Clinton wanted what George Stephanopoulos called a non-event, the smallest possible audience, because he was winning by virtually 20 points in the polls and didn't want anything to shake up the race. So they hatched a secret agreement.
That secret agreement specifically spelled out that only Bill Clinton and Bob Dole would debate, so Ross Perot was left out in the cold. 4 years later, in 2000, the Republican and Democratic candidates kept Pat Buchanan out of the debates too, although he had qualified for more than $12 million in public financing. Ralph Nader, who had made it onto the ballots in 43 states and the District of Columbia, was not only kept out of the debate, but was prevented from getting into a debate site, even though he showed up with a credential.
We all have the same so-called bag.
Yeah,
everyone got in but me.
I have no understanding why you are being instructed to do this. We have an official invitation from one of the major television networks.
Well, they're not allowing you access to the grounds.
Who's not allowing? The debate commission?
The debate committee, correct, sir.
And they have
I
to...
I really do not want
wait,
to get
no,
an
I don't
argument
want, no,
with
I don't
you
want to argue.
You seem like too nice of a
no,
man
no,
to
no,
argue.
I don't want to argue with. All I want to ask you is, this is a political exclusion. I'm not a security risk. I'm not being disrupted. This is a political exclusion. You should not be misused. The authority of the state of Massachusetts should not be misused for a political exclusion of a presidential candidate who has a ticket to be in Kripke Auditorium, to watch the debate on remote television, and who has an official invitation from Fox News. So,
okay, sir.
I make my point.
Very good. The Presidential Debate Commission excluded Ralph Nader and Pat Buchanan from the presidential debates. But they also wouldn't even let Mr. Nader into the hall. The independent presidential candidate was given a legitimate ticket by a student supporter for a remote area in the auditorium. But acting like thugs, officials threatened to have him arrested if he didn't leave the premises. Presumably, Mr. Nader's presence might have offended some of the commission's fat cat contributors in their prominent seats.
So why are third-party candidates being excluded? It turns out the Commission on Presidential Debates has stringent stipulations on participation. The first of which is evidence of constitutional eligibility. According to Article 2, Section 1 of the Constitution, a presidential candidate must be 35 years of age, a natural-born citizen of the United States residing here for 14 years, and otherwise eligible under amendments to the Constitution. The second is ballot access. A candidate must appear in enough state ballots to have a mathematical chance of securing 270 Electoral College votes to gain a victory in the 2012 general election. The third is an indication of electoral support. They must have a level of support of at least 15% of the national electorate, which is determined by selecting 5 national public opinion polls. The problem with this last stipulation is that the pollsters are unknown to the public, and the majority of polls only include the 2 major parties. Ralph Nader won almost 3 million votes in 2000, but still didn't meet that criteria. Let's listen to former Governor Jesse Ventura about what happens to third-party popular support if you're allowed to debate.
I proved you could win if you're allowed to debate. If you are allowed in the debates, the candidate that no one gives a chance to, lo and behold, can win. It's happened. I did it. I was polling at the primary a mere 10%. Now, this is 7 weeks before the general election, 10%. But I was allowed to debate, and we probably had a half a dozen or more debates. By the time the last debate took place, maybe 3 days before the election took place, I was polling now 27%. But let's remember now, you're in a 3-way race. So you got to throw out all those normal numbers. You're in a 3. Well, they were then calling it a dead heat between all 3. But here's what happened. The Secretary of State predicted there would be a 50% voter turnout that year because it was a non-presidential. Lo and behold, it ended up 60%. I was at 27, that additional 10% that came out and voted because I was allowed to debate people they didn't count on. See, if they open these debates up, more people that maybe normally would not vote will come out and vote.
The commission contends that if we remove the last stipulation, hundreds of candidates would be eligible to debate. This is demonstrably false. Candidates meeting the first 2 stipulations have been very manageable. With the 2012 election being the smallest race so far this century. So let's just see what would happen if in 2008 all contenders were allowed to debate. The question is, do you support the $700 billion bank bailout?
Number one, we've got to make sure that we've got oversight over this whole process. $700 billion potentially is a lot of money. Number two, we've got to make sure that taxpayers, when they are putting their money at risk, have the possibility of getting that money back and gains if the market and when the market returns.
The point is, we have finally seen Republicans and Democrats sitting down and negotiating together and coming up with a package. This package has transparency in it. It has to have accountability and oversight. It has to have options for loans to failing businesses rather than the government taking over those loans. It has to have a package with a number of other essential elements to it.
And also, it's not clear at all why a bailout is needed. That's part of the stampede and the pack and the panic that Bush and Paulson and Bernanke are pushing Congress toward. You know, it's eerily reminiscent when you listen to Bush yesterday, of how he stampeded the Congress and the country into the criminal war invasion of Iraq in 2003. I mean, look at all his statements. This could do this. This would do that. Farms failing. Small business. Ta-da, ta-da. The first question we have to ask as citizens is, why is there a need for a bailout?
And now we have the federal government, the Bush administration, coming to us, the taxpayers of this country, and saying, we want you to bail us out of the problem that we've created over the last 10 years by manipulating the financial and the mortgage markets through bad government policies that we knew were going to fail and cause these problems. You open the door to this. You throw open wide the barn doors here. This raid on the federal treasury, this raid on the taxpayers of this country, you'll know for a fact that it will happen again and again and again. Already, others are lining up. The automobile industry is already lining up for its bailout.
I think one of the things that we see that is facilitating this, perhaps more than any other, is highlighted recently by the bailout of the Wall Street banksters, as I like to call them, for the fraud that they have perpetrated against the American people. And I do not hesitate to use that word, fraud, because I believe the Federal Reserve is a fraudulent system. And I believe that what we must do is return America to sound money principles, which means we must abolish the Federal Reserve.
First of all, we need a moratorium on foreclosures. Secondly, we need to renegotiate all adjustable rate mortgages into 30 or 40 year loans. We also need to make sure that we redefine credit so that credit can work for small business owners and individuals and not against them. We also need accountability in the system, openness, transparency, and accountability.
Well, there you have it. If we juxtapose them with alternative voices, Republicans and Democrats seem to share pretty much the same views. This is probably the reason why you now see alternative factions making their voice heard, essentially sowing the seeds for a third party. Are we seriously going to remain satisfied by the supposed lesser of two evils? Either choice is a vote for evil. In 2012, we have a chance to hear alternative solutions, and possibly a chance to vote for the greater good. Today, the American Republic stands at the precipice. Our country faces a convergence of crises that I'm sure it's safe to say were primarily caused by the two major parties. For our democracy to survive, prevail, and thrive, we must have an open debate about the challenges we face and the solution we must apply. We don't need debaters prepped to look like a couple of game show contestants. We need serious debates. Friends, as things stand, the three debates run by the two parties through the Private Commission on Presidential Debates will exclude critical discussion. It's time to respect the will of the American people, to expand their access to arguments and facts that address issues central to their daily lives. It's time for the American people to take control of the political system. We can begin by opening up the presidential debates. So what can be done? Education is always the primary step. To learn more, check out these websites. You can also read George Farah's book, No Debate. In addition, you can try contacting Farah's organizations for current information or strategies. The next step is to put pressure on before the debates. Contact the major candidates themselves and let them know we want them to participate in real debates. Snail mail is the best way, but phone calls and emails help too. Contact the major third parties to help coordinate any possible strategies that they've developed. Contact the major news networks and tell them you want inclusive debates. Contact pollsters like Gallup and Rasmussen and tell them to include third-party candidates on their polls. Contact the major newspapers and periodicals raising this issue. You can even submit an editorial to your local newspaper. Contact recurring debate sponsor Anheuser-Busch and let them know you're boycotting their product if they support these non-inclusive debates. You can also contact this lady, Janet Brown, Executive Director of the Commission on Presidential Debates. Let her know that the first two stipulations are requisite enough and that 15% isn't feasible unless you're a billionaire or a celebrity. Use Jesse Ventura as an example of how debates can increase electoral support. Finally, if the debates proceed as planned, without third-party recognition, we can then occupy the debates. Without a doubt, protests will be organized at each debate site by libertarians, Greens, the Constitution Party, and others. Please share and re-edit as needed to raise awareness about this issue. Good night, and good luck.